to thank you for the opportunity this morning to bring the gospel. I want to thank our pastor for permitting me to bring it. Your paper that you have, if you want to write a title down, I can give you a title. The title is The Seal of the Holy Spirit. Not too awful long ago, and I'm going to give you the scripture that if you want to go to your phone or your Bible, that you can find it and just hold it right there, because everything is going to go pointing to Ephesians chapter 1, 13 through 14. There's a lot of people in this world today who like to show you they have the Holy Spirit, and they base it on a lot of things. But I want to share with you, there is nothing, nothing that can tell you you've got the Holy Spirit but by simple faith in Jesus Christ. And I'm going to point that out this morning. Some time ago in our adult Bible study, we were studying about Moses, and God had sent the plagues upon the children of Israel. And while I was studying this, there was a word that just jumped out in my spirit. And I knew the Holy Spirit was doing a work in me. It was in Exodus, and you don't have to turn to it. Exodus chapter 8, verse 23. And God said to Moses, he said, I want you to, Moses, to go tell Pharaoh that I will make a distinction between my people and your people. What God was literally saying is, my people are going to be different than the world. They're going to be a people that is completely different. The Bible says we are a peculiar people. Now, I also know that God was speaking to Pharaoh that he was going to do a thing in the physical to protect them. But my mind went back in time to a camp meeting that I listened to. And I remember a woman named Lily McCutcheons who preached a sermon, and some of that sermon carries with me all of these years. The word was distinction, a difference, than the world. So many people want you to know they're Christian, that they put tags on their cars. And if you have one, that's fine. Please do not think I'm offending you in any way. All I'm doing this morning is pointing at what Paul said. The simple words that Paul said is the absolute truth. A lot of people base everything to let the world know they're a Christian. But it's really that seal that God has put. You see, God chose you. You didn't choose him. People say, when I found God. No, you didn't find God. He found you. You were lost. But my mind went back in time to that point where Lily McCutcheons was talking. And it was about making a seal of a Christian. The difference from the world and its people. It's not a mark on the outside body. Now, I've always told my kids, when I die, I will be in the Smithsonian Institute. I'll be the only man that does not have a tattoo on him. And people will come from miles around, because everybody I know has a tattoo. I've had them tell me, it's a Christian tattoo. I'm not preaching about that. All I'm preaching tonight, this morning, is about the seal of the Holy Spirit. But God was saying, I'm going to do something, and it's not going to be on the outside of the body. I see so many people put big old crosses on their biceps, especially men, and I hear them cuss like a sailor. I see them drinking and carrying on. That's not a very good witness, and that shares to me right quick, the Holy Spirit isn't in that person. And I see them with verses on their arm. I want to tell you, I don't want none of that on me to put my Lord down, because I fail. But I do want the mark of the Holy Spirit that God chose. You see, I'm a very dramatic person. I like to do things. When I was saved, I like to tell people my story. If you watch my wife, she is a very simple faith person. Believe it, do it. She don't have big stories about her faith, but she knows she's been called out, and she simply believes. And of all the years that I'm that kind of person, God has chose me today to realize that no matter what he's done in me and how dramatic it is and how wonderful it is, that is not a mark of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit, it's very simple. And I want to get into that. The Kingsmen in 1986, that was the year that I got saved. Now, if you're a praise and worship person, you're going to say, the King who? When I first got saved, the whole world was different. I didn't know church people. I didn't know church talk. I didn't know anything. I didn't know about Pentecostal. I didn't know about Methodist. I just knew about a little church that I went to, and I walked in simple faith. But the Kingsmen came out with a song, and even now I still go through Google and like to listen to it, and it's called Called Out. It's, and I want to read you this because I'm not going to sing it. We didn't practice it. It says, some folks I know by their name. Some I just know their face. Some are known by their fame. Others are known by their race. But in the kingdom of our Lord, each soul has their place. Do you hear that? You have a purpose. God has called you out from the world if you're a born-again Christian. He's called you out to be different, not like the world. He's called you to shine for him. And I know that in 1986, God called my name to step out. And for all of you that's been born again, your name was called. Gary Underwood, one day his name was called to be a pastor. Each and every one of you. Lee, your name was called. It wasn't called you and Jamie. It was called singular, especially you. And each of every one of you that are here, your name, if you've been born again, your name was called by God himself to be different, to come out. He says here, but in my mind I have no doubt that my name was called out. And he goes on to say that you've been called out for a purpose. That's God's purpose. You were called out to be a servant for God. I want to tell you something. One of the hardest things that I've learned, because I'm a very prideful person, and you have no idea what I've had to go through, because God needs humble people, and I was the opposite of that. So God had to really sand me down, and he's still working. He still has to come back and break me deeply. It is said that for God to really use somebody, he has to deeply break them. I believe that. He has to get self out of the way, and we have to realize that I'm not here preaching because I'm so good. I'm not here for any other reason, but I'm a servant. Do you hear what a servant is? A servant. I'm here to tell you about our Lord and Savior, but not about me. And nothing that I can do or say, my prayers, I can pray for you. But that don't mean anything, really. Let me tell you. He also says, called out to lift the standard. What is the standard? The gospel of Jesus Christ and his teachings, his doctrines. We are called to live every day in that realm. We're called out to raise the banner. We're called out to be a witness to Jesus Christ. I told Brother Gary, I said, please do not think that I'm copying what you're preaching. Because he preached this not too awful long ago about us being a witness. He also preached about the Holy Spirit. But I'm just saying what I know God wanted me to say. We are called out to show forgiveness. Corey Ten Boom was after she was released, God had called her back to Germany to preach the gospel. And there on the front row was the very German who was responsible for the death of probably her father and her sister. And when she seen him, eruption came up in her soul, and she hated that man. And she turned to the Holy Spirit and spoke to the Holy Spirit like he'd speak to you and says, I will not preach the gospel to him. And the Holy Spirit said, if you cannot preach the gospel to him, the gospel is not for you. And she had to forgive that man. Have you ever been so hurt by someone And then God say, forgive them or I can't forgive you. It's not an option. It is a life that we live. We're to raise the standard to show the world that we are able to forgive. No matter what, that the gospel that lives in us is more powerful. I've had a lot of problems this year. And one of the main problems, if I could have it answered, would be my depression. I'd like to see it go back to the gates of hell. When allergies come in, a lot of the time my body gets so pulled down that I go into depression. It's like you're wanting to taste a big juicy steak, and when you put it in your mouth, it's nothing but hay. It has no flavor. That's my life. You can ask my wife, I change. It's hard to preach a sermon because I don't feel it. I'm like dead men's bones when this comes upon me. And I've asked God, why will you leave this? And God always says to me, my grace is sufficient for you, Billy. My grace can bring you higher even though you have it. You can overcome it and learn, and you'll be a greater vessel. They said in the song that they're called out from this world. They went on to sing in the song. They said in the prison walls on that day, the jailer bound up their feet, stripped of their garments, bleeding from where they were beat. But along about midnight, Paul began to pray. Let me tell you something. Paul was a living example of the seal of the Holy Ghost. He just had his back beaten raw for preaching the gospel. Everywhere he went, he was plagued with people trying to shut him up or kill him. And Silas was in the same boat, and Silas started having church. While the blood was running from their backs and bruising, they were having church. They'd already forgiven the ones that had did it to them. They were living out that seal of the Holy Spirit in their lives. It says the earth shook about, the doors opened wide, and God said, you've been called out. That's what they were called out for, to be a witness, to stand in those prisons. One of my wife's favorite gospel groups, I guess, is Charles Johnson and the Revivers. And there's a song that he sings that is called Sealed Until the Day of Redemption. Charles Johnson in that song gives his testimony about a sad, sinful life, a life lived of sin. But he said, then he hears about a man who died on the cross. And he said, that man, if I just simply believe in him, he said, I'm going to be sealed till the day of redemption. Now, some of you might think that I'm preaching once saved, always saved. You're wrong. I'm not going near that at all. I'm not preaching that. I'm preaching about the seal of the Holy Spirit this morning. Now, in the book of Ephesians, chapter 1, 13 and 14, if you ain't found it, that's going to be my main anchor right there. Because it's everything that Paul says, Paul summed it up. Paul said, having believed. Believed in what? I believe there's electric runs through those walls. When I was real young, and my oldest son, who's pushing 40, or is he 40? I don't even remember. He's right at it if he ain't. I was a young man, and I was working on a fan, and he was just a little bitty feller. And I had cut these wires, and I was putting a new plug in on that fan. And I just had my hands on both ends, twisting them, when I heard him say the words, put this in here. And I looked, and there it went. And then there I went. I was shocked. You see, I have faith that will shock me. I have faith in a lot of things. But Paul is talking about a simple faith of Jesus Christ. Do you believe that he is the Son of God? Do you believe that he came and was born and died and was resurrected for your behalf? That he gave his life on the cross for you? That is what he's asking. Do you believe? He says, if you believe, you were marked in him. You hear what I'm saying? Not in the Church of God, not in Pentecostalism, What I'm talking to you today is not about any denomination. It's something that God ordained for all people. And he didn't depend on me and you to make it happen. All he asks is you believe genuinely. He said you were marked in him with a seal, the promised Holy Spirit. Now, who is a deposit guaranteeing? Do you hear this word guaranteeing? Paul says God is guaranteeing that our inheritance until the redemption, that means till you pass away and go to be with the Lord, he said, are God's possession. You see, I am a possession of God. He chose me. I didn't choose him. That makes it a whole lot better to know, was I good enough? Oh, God, no. I rank from the smell of sin. I've found that God is a person, I believe, who goes to the junkyards a lot, and he picks people who are the most unlikely, and he works a miracle in their life. I'll never forget one of my cousins. She was older than I was, but when I first felt the call to be a preacher, later years she got up and testified. She said, I remember the day Billy stood up and said he was called to be a preacher. She said, if there ever was a word that I thought was not true, it was that. If God can make him a preacher, he could do anything. My mom used to say, you cannot take a sow's ear and make a silk purse out of it. Well, that's exactly what God does through the power of the Holy Spirit. He picks people of the most unlikely people, and then he works on them to be presented unto his Father. And it is in his possession. Do you hear me? His possession. And what are we in his possession for? To praise his glory. Many Christian men and women throughout the ages have had breathtaking religious experiences. I've had one. My wife, I can barely remember the time she has told me about the night she got saved. It's just, the experience isn't that important to her. It's the fact that Jesus chose her. That's the most important thing. Smith Wigglesworth was in the Baptist denomination. Him and his wife, they were workers in that denomination. And for some reason, Smith went over to a Pentecostal church with some people. And they laid hands on him, and Smith Wigglesworth began to speak in tongues. And I don't know if he wrote her or called her, because that was so long ago, but I think he called her. And she was very skeptical. Matter of fact, she was rather angry with him. And she told him, Smith, we'll see when you get home. So when he came home, she said, Smith, I want to be honest with you. I can out-preach you 2-1. She said, I'm better behind the pulpit than you are. She said, I don't mean to hurt your feelings, but you just give a little old sermonette. She said, if you really have got the seal of the Holy Spirit in you, then there'll be a change tonight when you go to that church and preach. And she went there knowing that he was going to fall flat on his face. But when it was over, she went up to her husband and said, Smith, I don't know what it is. I simply don't know. But she said, I do know there has been something inside of you that's changed you. And Smith Wigglesworth went on to be one of the great men of God. D.L. Moody, he was walking down the street, a shoe salesman that God had changed to make a man of God out of him, and the Holy Spirit came upon him. And while the Holy Spirit was touching him, he was so full of joy, he had to beg the Holy Spirit to back off, because he said, I fear I'm just going to explode. It will destroy my flesh. He said, I'm so happy. There was one named Charles Haddon Spurgeon in his latter years, and he's called the Prince of Preachers. America offered him great money to come across the waters and preach, but he would not sell his word. And when he was getting older in age, he was diseased, and he would sleep for 6 days. And on Sunday, he would arise and come to the pulpit, and he would have a chair there by him, and he would lean upon that chair because he was so weak. But they said, never was there any sermons that touched your heart greater than during that time when he was weak and the Spirit was strong. There was also Apostle Paul, when he said and shared with us, he said, I've fought a good fight. He said he knew his time had come, and he walked up boldly to that post where they would take his head off and they didn't have to drag him. He went boldly and happily. He had forgiven those that it was going to cut his head off before it even happened. There was also a German preacher named Dietrich Bonhoeffer. And I want to share with you, Dietrich stood up against Hitler, one of the only ministers during that time, and he stood up against him. And some of his people asked Dietrich, please go to America where you'll be safe. And he did, but as soon as he got into America, he said the Holy Spirit began to beckon him to go back to Germany. And he knew if he went back, that would be the end of his life. But he felt that the Holy Spirit wanted him to make that final sacrifice. I believe if he had not went back, I would not be speaking or even know about Dietrich Bonhoeffer. But the day of his execution, years later, the German guards who came to know Christ said it was because of him. They said, we never saw a man like him. Said he came out joyfully. He held nothing against us for what we were about to do. And he was ready to meet his God. And then we said, we knew he knew God. Charles Finney, who walked through a warehouse workery and never said a word, and people started giving their life to Christ because they felt something that drawed them to God, even though he never said a word. All of these are facts, but I want to share with you, Paul says they're not evidence of the Holy Spirit. He said, if you believe in Christ and you have accepted him, you possess the Holy Spirit. Doesn't that seem simple? Isn't it sad that too many people try to make it out? I remember one time I wanted to get a minister to come. And I'd made my decision to get him. And I went and heard him for the last time before I asked him, and these were his words. If you do not speak in tongues, you do not have the Holy Spirit. And I thought, that's not right. That's not right at all. Paul said, do all speak with tongues? No. And I'm not against tongues, and that's not my sermon. My sermon is this: to receive the seal of the Holy Ghost, there's nothing you can do at all but believe who Jesus really is. And with that belief, that when you really do believe that, God honors that. God does, not you. You don't have to repent and say Mother Mary and all this stuff. No, God does his part. He puts that seal of the Holy Ghost on you at that moment. Amen. Now, through our experiences with the Holy Ghost, we may find times of great joy, of great love. We may have times where we weep with joy because it's the Holy Spirit. But that is not evidence. Paul says they can never be the definitive evidence that you're a Christian. There must be this huge moral emphasis on the Christian faith. Do you hear what I'm saying? Simple, childlike faith, I believe. I don't have to join this church to get the Holy Ghost. I don't have to go out in the hall. I don't have to do anything. I receive it. I can't work. And all of my great experiences that I think is so powerful, that's proof that I have the Holy Ghost, is nothing, Paul said. Nope, all you can do for proof is simply believe. Do you believe with childlike faith? Did you make that decision when Christ came into your life? Because if you haven't, you're no more born again than a ball is lost to tall grass. Then a goose is in a snowstorm. They're lost and you're lost. You have to faithfully, simple faith, childlike faith, believe. You must believe the doctrines of Christ and of his teachings found in the book of Romans, the fundamental marks of the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. Not the present the presence of gifts of the Holy Spirit. Do you hear what I'm saying? Tongues is just a gift of the Holy Spirit, and not all have it. We all have gifts, the Bible says. Some of us have different ones, and God has chose a spot for you to work for him, every one of you. But you must have that seal. I've known many preachers, not many, but I've known a few who tried to be preachers and they couldn't handle it and they backslid. You know, I really believe by some mistake they didn't believe and they didn't have the seal of the Holy Spirit. You cannot do nothing for God without the Holy Spirit. I want to tell you, when you have the Holy Spirit, you're going to want to live like him. You're going to want to believe what Christ teaches because you love him for being your Lord and your Savior. One of the great songs that I love to hear is the Dallis, His Life for Mine. There's nothing that drives a tear in my eye quicker than to know what our Lord went through, and that song explains it. And it explains how unworthy I am and how much he loved me and what he bought for me. Everything is about Christ when you believe. This is the great mark of a person who has the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. You cannot not be a Christian without the Spirit of the living God. Do you hear me again? You cannot serve God and you cannot get the Spirit and serve God without the Holy Spirit. You have to live and breathe for Jesus Christ. Paul writes, having believed, you were marked in him with a seal, the promised Holy Spirit, who is a deposit, guaranteeing. Do you hear what I said? It don't matter what someone else says. Well, my denomination says you're not saved. God says, I guarantee you, if you came to me with childlike faith, I'd rather listen to God than some other person pull a hot air. He says, our inheritance until the redemption of those who are God's possession. Do you know that the mere Christian, just a common, everyday Christian, has the Holy Spirit? What is the marks of you having a Holy Spirit? That you speak in tongues? No. That I went to the universities and colleges and seminaries and I learned? No, that is not. Paul says it is not. I can prophesy. I can tell you that's not it either. I've had great experiences in my life. That's not either, Paul said. None of these things are the marks of having the Holy Spirit. He said there are two things in this text, Paul says. First, having believed. Let me ask you a question. The day you got saved, the day Christ came into your life, did you believe in this man called Jesus? Do you believe that he is the only way, God says, for your salvation? He is the only permanent payment for your sin, and that God will not look at any other? And that if you are living for him, you're going to believe his word and you're going to concentrate on it every day when you get up. I told my wife that if I die with any sense in my head, Jesus will be the last words I say. I really believe that because it's always him I think of when I wake up. It's always him that I look at throughout the day. Have you believed in Christ? You put your trust and your hope and your plea in the Savior, Christ Jesus. Your trust is not perfect faith. I remember Lily McCutcheon saying that, and it just stuck to me. I don't have to come to Christ knowing everything, because I don't. I know very little. All I know is I believe that he died for me on the cross, and that I'll put all my trust and all my faith in him. It isn't in a denomination. It is in him. And that my faith is infallible. But I believe right into the Lord Jesus Christ. The Bible says I'm saved, and I base everything on that. And that's what Paul says. You base it on the Word of God. We receive the promise of the Spirit by faith. Paul tells the Galatians, and he shares it with us. The other way that we have the Spirit is seeing the Word of God in him and seeing it lived out in our lives. He said, you were marked. Were, past tense, not present tense, past tense. The day you came to know him as your Lord and Savior and you trusted him, you were marked with the holy seal of God, the promised Holy Spirit. My mom used to can vegetables and fruit. She sealed those jars with a pressure cooker. And we survived off of them through the winter. You know why she did that? Because she wanted the flavor pushed in. Lily McCutcheon, I remember, was talking about this that day at that camp meeting. She said, we preserve the flavor to keep it in, and we seal it where the world and all the things that affect the flavor and try to spoil it is sealed out. That's what God does. He put a seal in us, not a denominational seal. No, it's a seal of God, of the Holy Spirit that he puts on you. And that comforter will be there to comfort you, to guide you, to keep the world from getting inside of you to ruin your salvation. You can't live this life without the Holy Spirit. It is impossible. What did Jesus say? He said, I can't remember the word, but he more or less said, it is necessary that I go away. That if I go away, he said, the Comforter will come. It's necessity for you to live the Christian life that you have the seal of God. And God made it simple. With childlike faith, you believe and you have it. One of the other things that I remember Lily McCutcheon's preaching about was the big woods up in the northern country. She said how these lumber companies would buy out all of these trees and they would plant trees. And he said they would come in and put a seal on those trees. And it would say that this belongs to so-and-so lumber company. And they would come and harvest it. I want to share with you on the day of harvest, God's seal is upon us. And it says, I belong to Jesus Christ. Amen? You are to be happy to realize it's not what you've done, it's what he done. God made it simple, simply believe. How many people in this world have the Holy Spirit? Everyone, Paul says, that is in Christ. It is impossible to be in Christ without the Holy Spirit. Now, who is the Spirit? Who is the Spirit that's active in God's people? It only works in God's people. Are you listening? He is the promised Holy Spirit, Paul said in verse 13. When I was a little boy, I was a small boy, and I wanted a bicycle. And my dad couldn't afford a new bicycle. So I remember he found one. I believe it was at the sale barn, the old sale barn. And he brought it home, ugliest bicycle I ever seen in my life. Ugly green. I was a little bitty boy. This was a great big bicycle. I couldn't sit on the seat and touch the pedals. I had to sit on that crossbar from boys, and it was painful. I had to put a little cushion there. But I could ride that bike. I didn't care if it was ugly. My dad had promised it. And he had came and give it to me. Well, I want to share with you, God promised you the Holy Spirit. Don't doubt it. Satan will try to convince you you don't have it. But God says you do if you believe in Jesus Christ, simply. Do you know Old Testament, many of the prophets foretold that God would give the new covenant people the Holy Spirit. He foretold it. They promised it. In Jeremiah 36:27, he says, I will put my spirit in you. Who's he talking about? The preachers? No. He's talking about everybody. Everybody. The janitor, those that just come to worship, he said, if you're mine, I'm going to put the spirit inside of you to seal you. Joel chapter 2 verse 28 says, I will pour out my spirit on all people. Did you hear that? So you see there, not one denomination has all of the answers. Not one denomination has the control of the Holy Spirit. God does.
It is impossible for God to lie, is it not? The scripture says it. So as he says, you have it, you have it. The one thing Satan wants, he wants to convince you you didn't get it. But Paul says you got it the day you believed. So what happened on the day of Pentecost when all of the people gathered in that one room? The Holy Ghost came in. I want to share with you what happened. The very promise of God is what happened. Those people that were there were sealed with the seal of the Holy Ghost. And from that point on, all over, all believers, all over the world who accept Christ from whatever country you want to point, if they in Japan, everywhere, Cuba, if they've called upon the name of the Lord and believed in him and believe that all that he's done, the Holy Spirit is given to them as a seal. Amen? Amen or oh me. Say something. I want to share with you. God has kept his word and he has given the Holy Spirit. What does he say? He says, repent and be baptized. And he says, you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. I want to share with you, don't be like the man that came to the prophet who had leprosy, Naaman. Naaman told him, the prophet told him, he said, go dip in the River Jordan 7 times. He didn't want to do it because it was so simple. Don't you underestimate the simpleness of God by making it simple for you and you believe you've got to work and earn it. You can't work and earn it. I don't care what you do. You're not good enough and you'll never be good enough. But God, out of his great grace and strength, chose you to be called out to be different. The church is trying to be like the world and God is trying to change us. The Holy Spirit is the seal, Paul says in verse 13. I'm just about done. I don't have very much left. In 2 Corinthians chapter 1 verse 22, the Bible says, who has sealed us and given us the earnest of the Spirit in our hearts. All those meanings are found in the very presence of the Spirit, in the life of a Christian. But the chief meaning is that the Spirit is in us and God asserts that we are his. Do you hear that? Not saying we belong to God, but God is saying, you belong to me. Hands off. Too many people are trying to show that they belong to God, but God made it simple. You believe, I will seal you with the Holy Spirit. There's no shortcuts. So you might say, Billy, are you saying everybody in the church is saved? Well, that would be a lie because the Bible speaks of the wheat and the tares. It speaks of those that look like, act like Christians, but they didn't believe. There's no seal there. God has signified that you're his by putting within you. Do you hear what I'm saying? Within you. He put his presence within the Ark of the Covenant, but when the New Testament came, he put it in you. God goes in to the very core of our heart, and there he applies the seal that we belong to him. We are very precious to God. God says, I love these from the foundations of the world. Can you imagine that? God loves you from the very foundations of the world. He said that I gave to my son to redeem. Do you think God would just give anybody? He chose those that carry that seal to be his sons. I want to share with you, in his son, the shepherd paid a very high price. What a mark of ownership that God is the Holy Spirit, is the seal that you belong to him. I'd like to ask, where is Lena? If she'd come up here, I want to sing a short, Just As I Am. And I want to share with you, I know I might be running just a little bit late, but I want to ask you today, let it be settled before you go out this door. Did you trust Jesus? Cindy, would you come up? Did you trust Jesus completely? Or did you base it on something else that you have the Holy Spirit? It's simple, childlike faith. I believe in Jesus, and I ask him to come into my heart. As they sing just a little bit of this chorus, I want the altars to be open. And if the Holy Spirit has stirred you, Bailey Smith is a, he's a Baptist minister, and he may be gone now. But he said he never wants to ever, and even Billy Graham said that, that when we leave, we need to get an invitation to the church. Because he said so many believe they're saved and they're not. He said, what is the real meaning? Simply by childlike faith, accepting Christ to come into your life and believing in him and him alone.